How's it going, everybody? This podcast is brought to you by Rise Make Life Workout, a health and self-development platform that produces high-performance results in personal productivity, lifestyle, mindset and strategy, and stress management.
Check out the website www.rise-workout.com for one-on-one coaching and details to the latest Rise event.
That's www.rise-workout.com. Enjoy the podcast.
That's a vibe. She wanna vibe. That's a vibe. Yeah.
How's it going, everybody? Welcome back to the High Frequency Club podcast. My name is Marwin Solerio.
And I'm Sinead Behrman. We're here talking all things self-development, growth, and mindset.
In this week's episode, we have Dr. Charlotte Connell, scientist and researcher. We talk about the effects of caffeine with training, as well as supplementation, its effectiveness with your training.
Yeah, and we also then dive into trackers and their effectiveness and utilization, I guess, as well in training for everyday people, and also, I guess, the more elite athletes, as that's what Dr. Char's background is in the field of exercise science.
She also leaves a really great practical tip. If you're looking at supplementation, what the process should be in terms of figuring out what works for you and that cost-benefit ratio.
Same with trackers as well. What you should be, the questions you should be asking yourself when either looking at using a tracker or if you already are using one, in order to make sure you're getting the best use out of it. So lots of takeouts in this one. Very sciencey lesson, which was awesome.
Yeah. If you find a song.
Check out at the High Frequency Club for more info. Like, comment, subscribe, and let us know your thoughts.
Peace. Yeah, I just wanted to start actually with a disclaimer, because obviously I don't come from the academic field, so there might be some points where I asked, can you explain that again, just because it's not relatable to me. As like, as you know, when me and you and Haim talk,
I'm
always asking like, wait, now hold up, what does that mean? It's because science was never a strong suit of mine. And I know it's like a real strong suit for you too, but yeah, I'm just a little slower than
you're not slow. I think it's just more, there's a lot of contextual sort of background. Like when Hamish and I are talking, for example, we both have that background of like how research works in the university, and so we sort of dive into it with a lot of that assumed knowledge, and so forgetting that not everyone comes from that. It's just an oversight.
I appreciate that. Yeah. Yeah, you're so right, because it is that. Because sometimes when I hear you and Hamish talk, I'm like, fuck, I can't keep up. Because I'm still trying to process that information. But then when I ask you guys, can you guys explain it? It makes a lot more sense to me when you guys make it in my terms.
I think I'm the same. Like, my close friend group has always been physio friends.
Yeah.
So we just always talk about the same stuff, and it's not until I'm with other people that are like, what do you mean by that? Or I'm like, well,
what does that acronym mean?
They always assume it's like common knowledge, and then you're like, oh, you're not a physio, okay?
Yeah.
So, yeah. But...
yeah, sweet. Well, I'm glad I got that out of the way. Just a little insecurity of mine. But did you want to explain to us who you are, where you're from, what do you do, and what your work is all about?
Okay, so I am Charlie, or Dr. Char is my nickname, I guess. I'm a research scientist and lecturer at the University of Auckland, and I work between the School of Medicine and the Faculty of Medical and Health Sciences and the exercise sciences department. And my job, basically at the medical school, I work doing research on the health workforce, basically. So we're really interested in looking at where our New Zealand medical trained grads actually go, what career paths they take and why they take them. And that can be really helpful for us to know, because we have workforce shortages around the country when it comes to our medical grads, or medical doctors, I mean. And so knowing those factors that influence what they decide to do with their careers can help to influence the design of different policies or different initiatives that med school or the government might take to try and help those shortages. Mm-hmm. Then in the exercise sciences department, I lecture in the undergraduate course there, and I also co-supervise graduate students there, and I'm part of a lab called the Exercise, Nutrition and Neurometabolism Lab. It's quite a long name. And so I do some of my research that I'm currently working on out of there, but I also did my PhD in that lab as well. Yeah, so in that lab, we're largely focused on looking at how different interventions affect your performance and the brain mostly. And an intervention mm-hmm. could be things like certain supplements like caffeine or creatine, or it could be some type of physiological challenge that we impose. Mm-hmm. So that might be restricting oxygen. It could be making people exercise in really high temperatures, so it's really mm-hmm. difficult to maintain your performance in that scenario, or restricting substrate, fatiguing people, getting them to exercise for a really long time. So yeah, that's sort of an overview of my work context.
Busy gal. Do you live at work, or do you have maintain a good work-life balance?
Yeah, I think so. It took a while.
Yeah.
During my PhD, I definitely didn't, but I got a lot better at it as I, got more experience working in that area. Because you can, there's always so much to do, so.
Yeah. And so what was your undergrad? What got you into?
So I did an undergrad in a Bachelor's of Science majoring in exercise science.
Okay.
I actually wanted to do physiotherapy, but I got a scholarship to go to the University of Auckland, and so I basically picked what seemed like the closest to physiotherapy, even though exercise sciences is definitely not physiotherapy, because you don't have a set career. You're not like a certified clinician or anything afterwards. So
So you just were always interested though in sort of human body exercise, all that kind of thing as well?
Yeah, definitely. I think, sciences actually wasn't my main interest at high school. I really loved history and geography. And so when I finished, I was kind of conflicted about what area to go down, because I really enjoyed those subjects, but I also didn't know what type of career I would want to enter if I was to go on and study them further. Mm-hmm. And then, I just generally have always been interested in exercise and sports, and so that's sort of how I ended up kind of formally studying exercise science.
Cool.
So with the supplements that you research, so it's you research supplements and their effects on people's performance, and by people's performance, is it just athletes in general or everyday type of people in general? Like, what's the spectrum of people that you researched?
Well, for my research, I usually used a healthy population. So they have to be reasonably fit, because a lot of the things that I make them do require them to like be able to sustain exercise for 3 hours. But I personally wasn't looking in my studies at elite athletes. One of my graduate students at the moment is looking at elite athletes and how some of the stuff that I looked at maybe differs in that population, but I was largely just using a healthy active population. And the stuff that we're more interested in looking at is the effects of those interventions on the brain specifically, so it's definitely more of like a neuroscience angle to the research, as opposed to does this improve sports performance? Does this increase your time trial performance or something like that, if in the case of like a cycling or running or whatever?
And what supplements specifically did you research?
So I did a lot of work on caffeine. And it was used to really try and get at the mechanism of underlying some of the things that I was interested in. So my early work is mostly focused on fatigue. And so when you, what's the best way to explain it? When people think of like exercise fatigue, you mostly just think of something that's sort of, you're doing like some type of exercise and it starts to, your muscles start to wear out. And you kind of think of it as being something that is born in the muscle, because you largely experience it that way. Could be due to like accumulation of different metabolites in your muscle, or like you've run out of the substrate that you need to fuel the exercise. But usually people just think of it as that. There's actually also though a large component of fatigue that resides in your brain and your central nervous system. And my work is particularly interested in those processes and understanding those better. And in the past we haven't had a very good way of looking at those or measuring them, so that was really what my work initially was around, is how can we somehow objectively detect fatigue during exercise, during or after exercise, in the brain and central nervous system, and then what are the processes that could be underlying that? And that's sort of where the caffeine comes in, because there's a hypothesis around central fatigue or brain fatigue that it's driven by a imbalance in inhibition and excitation, or the neurotransmitters that that are responsible for managing that in the brain, basically. So as you exercise, you either get an accumulation of certain neurotransmitters or a depletion of them. Caffeine mediates most of its effects just by, it mostly mediates its effects centrally, so by its action on the central nervous system rather than some other peripheral action that it has in your muscles. So that's why we used it as an initial supplement to try and test out that hypothesis, because it upregulates those neurotransmitters that we're interested in.
Gotcha.
So.
Gotcha. So when you drink,
was that like real?
No, that yeah, I'm
confusing.
Fascinating. No, interesting. Okay. Very interesting.
Yeah. So yeah, when you drink caffeine and it has an effect on your central nervous system.
Yeah.
Because it has an effect on your central nervous system talks to the rest of your body, and that's what mediates the performance.
Yeah, so caffeine in my research. So without caffeine, what I did is I got people to exercise for a really long period of time. So they were exercising for 3 hours, and then I used an index of fatigue that I'd tested out, which was actually looking at eye movements, to see how those were affected. So that was my index of whether or not the central nervous system was affected by the fatigue. After exercise without any caffeine, we found that people's eyes moved significantly slower than what they moved before caffeine. Before exercise. And then with the caffeine, we found that there was a reversal of that effect. So that effect was gone. It seemed to mitigate the deficit that you have from being fatigued for that long. And because of the central effects of caffeine upregulating certain neurotransmitters that we think deplete over the time course of prolonged exercise and create that central fatigue, that sort of suggests that those are probably somewhat involved. So it's not, that work is not necessarily like directly applicable to how you wouldn't use that in your training so much, but it does tell us something that we didn't know about the central nervous system and brain-based fatigue.
Did you guys look at different dosage as well of caffeine and time of consumption as well during?
We settled on there's heaps of work around like the best sort of the optimal caffeine dose for different types of, or it really depends what the sports context is or the performance gain that you want to make is. So we settled we didn't really play around with the dosing too much. We stuck with a standard dose that's going to work pretty well for most people in endurance exercise, which is 3 to 6 milligrams per kg body weight. So if you ever are running a marathon or anything, then that's sort of the dosing that you want to go for. But we did look at the effect of the timing of it. So in one of the studies, we gave it in the middle of exercise. And then in another one, we gave it beforehand as well, just to sort of see. And that didn't change the overall effect on brain-based fatigue, but you can definitely see a difference in the subjective, like the perception that you have over exercise. So my personal preference with caffeine is to have it after you've actually started the exercise, sort of some way in, like if you're doing a marathon, do it like 45 minutes in, because you're already sort of starting to feel the beginning effects of fatigue. And then that caffeine gives you a really big boost, and it just feels like you're flying for a good portion of it, as opposed to having it beforehand and kind of potentially because at rest sometimes that dose can sort of give you the jitters. It's quite high. It's not, it's a lot higher than what you'd have in like a coffee or something like that.
So if someone's listening, if they're a person who's just going to do classes, it's all good to drink right before.
I mean, it will make it feel just for your general use, is definitely
Like I said, I guess different sporting contexts where you're looking at endurance sports versus just if you're only doing a 30 minute or 45 minute hit type training versus wanting to be able to sustain an output for 3+ hours.
I mean, because people also are quite like have a habit around caffeine as well. Like I personally have a coffee every day, and so I tend to time those. And if I'm working out in the morning, I time them around the workouts in a way that's going to help me feel good in them. But if I was, I've definitely pulled back on my like habitual caffeine around times when I've done certain events and things, because you want the caffeine to have maximum effect to give you that performance boost during the actual event. So like a marathon or a half marathon. I sort of, I'll change my habitual caffeine intake and then think kind of carefully about when I want to take it, how many, the dosing I want to take and how much to take. But
What about really, what about when you don't have a marathon on and it's just like a normal day? Do you still drink coffee then?
Oh yeah, definitely. It makes me so happy.
I feel you.
Do you think part of it is, I guess, I don't know how you would have controlled for that in your study, but I guess if you blinded people in regards to that, like you said, that subjective or placebo of being like, oh, I've had coffee, now I'm more alert and I'm more.
Yeah, that is a really good point, because blinding people to caffeine is really, really hard. So we gave, in the studies, we didn't use coffee, we gave people pills. So they had like a placebo sugar pill or a pill with caffeine. So there was no taste. There's no way they could really have known, but people are so familiar with what it feels like to have had caffeine that usually they've probably figured it out. But even so, like we did do like so I was blinded as the experimenter, they were blinded to like when they were actually taking the pill. We still found if you give people the caffeine at the beginning, you'll still get like a higher perceptual lift in terms of the work feels a lot easier, you're in a better mood, you're like more highly aroused and awake than if you were to then when you just give them placebo.
Maybe I should get back on the no dose. That got me through uni because I didn't drink coffee, so I was a no dose gal during coffee.
You don't like coffee?
Nah.
Oh wow,
I love coffee.
It's not like the taste, it's not black. It's never been like an anti-caffeine thing, which is more the taste. But so to get me through uni on long days, long nights was caffeine pills. My friends are like, they're so bad for you, and I'm like, it's just caffeine. Like one tablet apparently is the equivalent of a cup of coffee. So I was like, how's it any different to you having three coffees in a day if I had three tablets? And I still slept fine. Like it never really affected.
Much is too much coffee?
Well,
I say that caffeine. How much is too much caffeine?
I mean, it does depend what you're using it for to some degree. So there's a when it comes to, so if you think of it like on a graph, you've got like your performance benefit, and that could be like your how awake you feel or how good you feel. There's also some motor symptoms of caffeine as well, so it can make you sort of jittery at certain doses. But you have like an inverted U on that graph, so you've got dose along the bottom and your performance on the y-axis. So it depends on the context. You obviously you want to maximize like the dose. You want your performance to be highest. Find the dose where your performance will be the highest. But that what that comes out at will be really different. So if you're just sitting at your desk and you're working, then the dosing of 3 to 6 milligrams per kilo of body weight is going to probably be too much, because you'll end up getting some of those motor symptoms that aren't that nice and sort of detract from your ability to work.
Yeah.
A much lower dose, probably below 3 milligrams per kilo of body weight, would be better for that. Whereas definitely for endurance exercise, anything longer than an hour, or 30 minutes, anything longer than 30 minutes really, I would, you want somewhere in that range, probably like between 3 to 6. Beyond that, it starts to get, beyond that, you start to be on that part of the inverted U where you're getting actually decrements in performance, or it's not really providing any benefit because it's too much.
Gotcha. So if you're just sitting on your desk and you have a coffee, it's best to have the lower dose because you're not exerting much energy. But if you are exerting a lot of energy, it's better used to take the higher dose.
Yeah, it would be. Yeah, because you won't notice the motor, the sort of motor symptoms that you would perceive as being kind of annoying and that jitteriness
when you're
sitting down. Yeah. But when you're exercising, you don't notice it. It actually, because you're engaging your motor system, it's actually
That's so true. Yeah. It's so true because, like, for example, today before I was teaching sprint, I first thing I do is drink my coffee.
Yeah.
And because I'm sitting in the car, I'm fucking getting anxiety. But also there's that part of anxiety because I know I'm about to teach too, but it was real heightened today and I was like, fuck, this is almost anxiety attacks on, you know.
Yeah.
So I'm trying to breathe it out, but once I'm in actually doing it, and then even after teaching the class, that was completely gone. Cool. What other findings did you have? What time do you stop having coffee to have a good sleep?
Well, that's quite personal. I personally am quite sensitive to it, so I don't have coffee after 1 p.m. usually, but somewhere between like 1 and 4 is usually the advice to sort of don't have it in the afternoon. Especially if you have trouble sleeping.
Yeah.
People's sensitivity to caffeine will differ as well.
Yeah, so you just said because you're quite sensitive to it, but you have coffee every single day. I have coffee every single day.
Yeah, yeah.
Does that not, do you not get used to?
Yeah, build up your tolerance.
You're not sensitive to one cup anymore, you're sensitive to two, sensitive to three. Is that how it works? Or is there a cap to how sensitive you can be?
Well, yeah, I mean, you do build up a tolerance. I think with my habitual caffeine intake, I do it for more reasons than just like chasing the high that comes with the caffeine, you know. I do it partly for the social aspect of it and also because I like the taste, and in that case I sort of can draw the line at, like, I know if I have more than two coffees in a day and, you know, if I have it after a certain time of the day, I'm going to have trouble sleeping. So you kind of do that cost benefit analysis in your head when it comes to your like own personal.
That's when I got to. That's why I ended up quitting Odos. I was having like four a day and just not feeling the effect. And I was like, and people were like, no, you shouldn't be taking them. And I kind of got to my mom, like, well, yeah, I'm still like needing a nap in the afternoon and wasn't feeling the effect. And then I still remember though, when I went off them, I did like have a good headache for 2 days straight. And that's when I was like, whew, okay, maybe it was having an effect on me. But once I like rode that out, then I was like, nah, I'm all good. As long as I always prioritize my sleep, I felt like I could kind of get through and not need any sort of pick me up, I guess.
But
Yeah, was there anything in your caffeine findings that surprised you, or that is like, you know, a general myth?
Not in my own work, to be honest. It's such a extensively studied like ergogenic aid or supplement that, yeah, I really had quite a lot of confidence in the way that we were using it in that research context. And also it was very helpful for me at the time because I was cycling competitively, and so I'd use some of that knowledge to kind of help me in supplementing my races and things like that, and dosing correctly, because it's not banned in sport either. So it's one of the few that works, definitely, and then it's also not banned. So you can use it
whenever.
Yeah.
Moving on to still staying on the topic of supplements, what other supplements have you researched?
So one of the supplements that we have researched a bit in the lab is creatine. What have you used that?
There was a point in when I was doing a lot of bodybuilding and I did a show and blah, 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 blah. And I was on a fuckload of supplements, a whole stack of supplements, because you get told by your coach or the other bodybuilder that's training beside you that they use creatine, glutamine and all this other shit, right? Creatine I used, but then, to be honest, I didn't really know something about water being pushed to your muscles, but I didn't know how it was meant to feel. I just took it because I got told to take it.
So right.
If you could clarify what creatine is and what it does, and Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, have you ever taken it actually before?
Yeah.
Did you find, what were you using it for, and did you sort of find
just going to the gym. So I probably didn't need it for what I was doing, but I definitely felt more of a difference with that versus other times when I've just used, like for a while I went through, say, I'm using BCAAs or pre-workout and stuff, and I found with that stuff, Sam, I didn't really feel a huge effect in my energy output per se.
So the creatine, right, is something about ATP energy.
Yeah.
That's what it gives to you. And it's in the first, like, 15 seconds of burst of energy.
So...
Because naturally you've got it, right? You've naturally got ATP storage.
Your body produces creatine.
Yeah.
It produces a small amount, but we also get it from our diet. So we get it from usually meat and poultry, like fish, stuff like that. But when you supplement with it, so creatine within the body is taken up by like metabolically active tissue, so by your muscles, and it's stored in there. When you take on more of it, there's obviously more of it that can be taken up by your muscles, so your muscles are generally storing more of it than when you don't take creatine. But within the muscle, what happens is you have it stored. There is a enzyme called creatine kinase. So it's stored as phosphocreatine in the muscle, So it's stored creatine and then a phosphate molecule. You have creatine kinase that essentially breaks that bond between the phosphate and the creatine, liberating that phosphate. Mm-hmm. And so now you have an extra phosphate molecule that can be reunited with an ADP molecule, which is ATP without the phosphate that got taken off during the chemical reaction when you're like releasing energy. And so it's a really fast way of replenishing ATP in the muscle, and that's why it's helpful to have for exercise that happens without oxygen essentially occurring. So because you've got your ATP stores in your muscle, then you have your creatine. So ATP will be used up really quickly, like less than 10 seconds kind of. Then your creatine phosphate within the muscle, that will be used up probably between like 10 to 20 seconds. And then what is it? You've got anaerobic glycolysis, aerobic glycolysis, and then aerobic lipolysis. So that that creatine supplementation supports that creatine phosphate system. And it's, I mean, bodybuilders use it because it is helpful when you're doing repeated repeated exercises that are less than 20 seconds long, basically. But it's also really handy for like sports athletes as well, which I don't know if many people know about. So if you're a rugby player or anything that involves repeated sprinting, creatine supplementation is awesome for that, because your power output, because you can recover and replenish
faster
between bouts, so your output, like after the first bout, the decrement is not as much as you sort of go down as if you weren't supplementing with
creatine. You endure so much more.
So that's another supplement that actually is supported by research when it's used for, in particular, you know, for very certain or specific scenarios. If you wouldn't really supplement with it if you're an endurance athlete, I don't think. Probably better off.
Yeah, because it's got to be in the short, sharp burst, right?
Yeah.
Does it make that 10 to 20 second last longer by supplementation?
No, it would be, I'd say, so with the, I mean, the repeated bouts, it basically allows you to get your muscles back to a state where they're ready to go again.
Yeah.
And as fresh as they can possibly be after having already worked. If you're using it just for lifting, it will generally improve the quality of the workout, because you'll be able to lift with fresher muscles. And so for training in the gym, like maybe bodybuilding or something, it could be useful there, because the quality of your reps and sets are consistently good, as opposed to sort of, you know, tailing off. The water thing actually is because it's stored with a water molecule.
Right.
So often, yes, if people don't realize that it's stored with a water molecule, and you're a person with quite a lot of muscle, then you'll put on like 1 to 2 kgs of weight when you start supplementing with it. And sometimes people think that's like working. It's like they put on like...
put on 2 kgs of muscle.
It's not actually that.
It's just water.
Yeah.
So it pushes more water into your muscle. Does it make you look any different? because of the water? Puffy?
Not that I'm aware of.
Mm.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. What about...
Oh, sorry, but just to add to that, the reason that we were looking at that is because it's used in sports a lot and exercise, but we were looking at creatine and how... because creatine is stored in the muscle, in the brain, sorry, as well as the muscle. So right. In periods where your brain might be deprived of oxygen, it could be an additional energy source that would allow that tissue to remain active for longer. So there's a couple of different applications for that we're sort of researching.
So yeah. We've talked about creatine for specific things. For example, like athletes or bodybuilders or anyone that... What about everyday people? Is creatine good for everyday people?
I wouldn't say so. I think if you have a well-balanced diet anyway, then you shouldn't need it. And actually, supplementing with creatine can reduce your body's ability to produce it itself.
Naturally, yeah.
Yeah, that will come back when you stop supplementing with it. It won't damage your ability to, but if you're not actually using it for some sort of specific fitness goal or performance gain, that's quite, that you've thought about.
Mm.
Like if you're just a recreational runner or you're just doing like the odd body pump class thing.
I reckon it would be more trouble than it's worth.
Yeah. And more expensive than what you're getting out of it as well.
Yes, like
If you're buying a, $60-$80 tub.
Yeah.
And don't really need it.
What about glutamine? What's glutamine?
Oh my gosh. Now we're getting into a lot of supplements that I don't know much about.
Mom's got a list.
Yeah. I just see all these supplements, sometimes in the staff room, blah, blah, blah. And to be honest, apart from what the sales consultant and what I have looked at on Google, which is in a way biased already because I'm looking on why it should work for me, I'd love to hear from, a doctor or professional or someone. I'm sure you just know more than me, more than
a scientist in the field.
Yeah.
Generally, I have to say we've mostly stuck to supplements that we know work and have an application in the brain. But generally, what we actually in one of the exercise nutrition courses that a colleague of mine takes, he takes people through a lab where he basically gives them a list of all these new fandangled supplements that supposedly do all this all these wonderful things, and the students get assigned one, and they have to go away basically and appraise the research behind it. They have to look at how it works, whether that actually makes sense physiologically, like whether that what they say it does, would it lead to the effects that they're claiming it has, how much evidence is backing up those claims in the scientific literature, to try and make an appraisal for themselves about would they use it, what applications would they use it in, and essentially doing that cost benefit analysis of like, is it worth it given the either lack of evidence or lots of evidence. I have to say I don't know much about glutamine in particular.
Well, what's your thoughts on, because the supplement industry is huge right now.
Yes, yeah.
It has been, sorry, for a long time. What's your thoughts on, the different types of supplements that you use for research-based and pharmaceutical-based compared to the stuff that, we see in, supplementation stores, which is, just the everyday Joe Blog can buy.
Yeah, I sort of... I generally have quite a healthy skepticism towards most of them. I know I am very comfortable with the ones that I know work, that I've worked with myself, and so I'm open to new supplements, but it would take a lot for me to start using them, and I'd have to have something, some type of event or something to use them in, I think, because a lot of the time with certain supplements that I'm a little bit skeptical at how much the performance gain actually is providing if you're taking them like every single day. Like what's that gain really, what's the utility of it? So if I'm training for an event that I really want to smash. I want to get, you know,
yeah.
I want to get a personal best time or something like that, or I want to be able to sometimes even finish, like caffeine will often help you just get through a race or something, then that's providing a very clear performance benefit for me. If I've looked at some type of supplement and it's kind of like it could provide like a 1-2% improvement in performance, given like where I'm performing in sport, a 1-2% one is like kind of negligible. If you're an elite athlete and, you know, it's a 100-meter race, like 1-2% is a
big deal. Yeah.
And so, you know.
But the average person, that's probably just like the difference between a good night's sleep or not.
Yeah.
Or like having a good dinner versus having takeout or.
Yeah.
Yeah. And probably other little things that they could be prioritizing their time and money and energy into versus like, oh, I've bought all these supplements to help me, might help my performance when they're probably not nailing the basics.
Yeah, that's kind of, yeah, that's sort of where I'd say I sort of fall into that line of thinking when it comes to for my own use. I mean, obviously people can do what they like, but I'm quite skeptical about the supplement industry. I don't know if what we were talking about before was on there, but I was saying to you that they're not regulated the same way that like the pharmaceutical industry is, or the food and beverage industry is either. So the claims they can make aren't, they're not regulated. They're not sort of.
No one's looking at them. Yeah. No one's asking how did you come up with that. It's not
necessarily backed up.
Yeah, and they don't have to go through like the phases of clinical trials that like a drug has to in order to get to market. So a supplement can be put on the market and sort of claim like, this is what we think it does. And
why is that? What do they fall under? What do they fall under if it's not food and beverage or drug?
It's, well, isn't it nutraceuticals?
Yeah, something like that.
I don't know. Yeah. Is it? Shit. That's scary, eh?
Well, that's similar to like vitamins and minerals. Yes, like that's the same in that you could go buy different vitamins just from like Countdown and you're not to know if that's, you know, like 90% of that particular vitamin or if there might only be like 10% of that vitamin and 90% of something else. So, yeah, you don't. No, I guess, like you said, unless it is a drug that's been through all those tests.
So what should an everyday person look for if they're wanting this vitamin mineral supplement? Oh, how do they know?
Vitamins or minerals. I think one of those, that would be... The first question to ask is whether you're in... If it's vitamins and minerals, if you're actually in a space where you even need it, is your diet not meeting those needs? And if that's the case, then go see a specialist about that and they'll help you try and meet those needs within your diet. In terms of, I think with sports supplementations, being really skeptical about the different ones that you see, knowing that there are a couple of exceptions. So we talked about caffeine, creatine, sodium bicarbonate is one as well. Those ones really do work and are worth looking into, but a lot of the other ones are a lot of noise. And just sort of before committing to that, maybe do a critical evaluation of those claims that come with those different supplements. And what it's really adding to your life. If you're an elite athlete, by all means, like look into the ways to get that performance edge that's within the rules of your sport. But for every day use at the gym, I guess there's sort of a few more factors that have to go into play around cost and how easy it is to use and whether it's worth it to you personally.
I know that we've spoken before over beers about fitness trackers. Because a couple episodes back we talked about how fitness trackers, you know. Oh, did you want to go into this? Because this was Julian.
About how people get so reliant on them, and to the point that I find that people become detached from being able to listen to their own body because they're just so reliant on different trackers and apps. But I do feel that they have a place in regards to if someone, like we touched on before with diet, if someone, if you've never tracked your diet, you might not be sure if you are getting enough iron or enough protein or enough zinc or whatever. And so that's where tracking what you eat for a week would probably be good to see. Yeah, like, yeah. Oh shit, I'm only getting 50% of the amount of protein it says someone with of my age and weight and activity should be getting. But then, like I said, if you're then tracking religiously every day and sort of getting too focused on it, that's when I think it's not the best thing. But
yeah,
so I was sort of coming up from that point, but yeah.
No, I agree with you on that generally. Also, tracking is one of the... So when we use it in the lab, we're often using it for some type of... to control for things, because we get people to come in on repeated visits, and sometimes we want to make sure that they're generally in energy balance, like they're each time. So if mm-hmm. they come in 1 week for some type of experimental session, we want to make sure they generally have had the same intake as mm-hmm. the next week when they come in as well, if we think that's going to be some type of confounding factor. But even even using that tool in that respect, it's not it's quite hard to get people to adhere to it, so you have actually a really good idea about what they ate, because tracking, especially if you're active, is such a pain in the ass. You're eating so much food. Well, I am. That like trying to keep track of that is already a big enough of an ask to do over a week, let alone continually doing it every day for a prolonged period. And yeah, so I sort of,
like I said, probably unless you've got those specific performance goals, like, is it necessary to be
to be doing
tracking the internet? And like I said, for your research and studies as well, if you are looking at performance measures as well, like in regards to someone's VO2 max or their peak heart rate or their time trials, all those sort of things, it's, you know, fair enough that you're needing to measure for all of those things. And again, if you were someone that's training for a marathon or whatever and you need to get your times down, yeah, I think fair enough that you need to be tracking. But I'm more talking to the everyday people that end up getting too hung up and fixated on that, versus just you should be exercising and moving your body because you enjoy it, versus like, oh, I've got to burn 500 calories otherwise my workout doesn't count, or I've only burnt this much, I better go for a run today, and my heart rate only got to 170, so I better do another grit session because that wasn't high enough, and that kind of thing.
How accurate are those trackers, just based on the data that you input, now all of a sudden it says it's X amount of heart rate per, I don't know, hour session? How accurate are they?
Well, so I mean, the heart rate, if you're getting a wrist heart rate, it's somewhat less accurate than a chest strap, for example, but those do give a reasonably good they give a reasonably good measure of your heart rate. Usually I find, because we test both, and they usually align in the lab, like one taken from a wrist and one taken from a chest strap. I think it's more the interpretation of the data once you've got it, in the case of heart rate in particular, because like taking max heart rate as something that's representative of your amount of effort in a workout is probably not the best metric to use. Heart rate can be really useful if you're doing like training or heart rate training zones for endurance exercise. And like you wouldn't necessarily want to do that in strength training. So the tool like kind of has its limits depending on what your fitness goal is. Also, looking at heart rate, I find personally, because I've got more of a background in cycling, I find it much more informative about whether I'm particularly fatigued or whether I've made a lot of improvement by using my heart rate in conjunction with power output on a bike, because then you can actually look at, 4 weeks ago, before I started my training program, I was outputting this much on the bike at this heart rate. Now I'm outputting the same amount at a lower heart rate.
I'm getting fitter.
Yeah. And so using the tool in that way is really informative and helpful. And it can help you track your progress. It can also help you kind of mark, am I over fatigued, or am I overtraining somewhat? Because this just, my heart rate's through the roof, and I'm hardly outputting what I would normally do. Because heart rate can also be affected by like how dehydrated you are as well. So it's not the best thing to take on its own to inform whether or not you worked out hard enough, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah, so heart rate is, it's a good tool, and the tools we have now to measure it, even just like our wristwatches and stuff, they do a great job. But yeah, I think it's more around the, yeah, how you choose to use that information. And some of that requires a little bit of more in-depth knowledge and looking into it before kind of, so that you can understand the limitations of the measure and then sort of interpret it knowing those things.
Yeah,
and not disengaging from the other sources of information that you're getting from your body around how you might feel during a workout. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, because I remember you saying that people don't even read, because I've never used it, right? So I wouldn't know. And so I've got the questions around it. But I remember you saying that a lot of people don't even read the Learn More, which comes with the iPhone, you know, and that's where it actually tells you how to use it. A lot of people just turn it on, just use it, and then
it'd be like, wow.
Well, yeah, without them actually understanding how it's read or how it's meant to be interpreted.
Yeah.
Or how they came up with that number.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you can sometimes have, it can be difficult knowing a lot about a certain area, particularly that sort of stuff, and how different measures might, could potentially be used more effectively, and watching someone do it. But then also knowing that if you went into more depth, you'd probably they'd probably stop listening, because it gets a bit boring. People kind of want to just like get to the point, but you're like, wait, but there's a caveat. Don't forget about this, you know.
That's it. Old age bloody battle and war between, I guess, the commercial part of things and the actual science part of things, eh?
Yeah.
It's do you see that gap being lessened now? Do you see it's getting smaller?
The commercial part of things being...
Because I think... You're right. A lot of people don't want to see the scientific shit. They don't want to like read it or anything like that. They just want to take it because it's shiny and colorful and blah, blah, blah. I don't know where I'm going with this, to be honest.
Yeah, I kind of know what you mean. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, that... I guess we're talking about an Apple Watch. It's like, cool, I've got a new Apple Watch. Look, I burnt 400 calories and my heart rate's this. Without, understanding, like I said, well, understanding what that knowledge means and what are you going to use that for versus just using it as like a cool, like...
That's it.
Or getting obsessive over it, and that leading to sort of that influencing your behavior in a way that actually is not
influencing your training, not for a good reason, versus like you said, something like understanding like your relationship between heart rate and your power output or other factors that you could be using to actually better your training and get more performance results if that's what you're after.
I mean, the technology we have now is amazing. Like the stuff that you almost have a whole lab on your wrist with the Apple Watch in some cases. And then if you combine it with some of the machines that we have at the gym, like the Watt bike, that has some really good exercise tests and like a power watt meter that you can kind of like follow through, connect with your watch. That's essentially like doing some of the fitness testing in the lab that you could just do in the gym, but it requires a lot of knowledge in the area to be able to, you can do it, but whether you can interpret it at the end is another question, and it will require obtaining quite a bit of knowledge to be able to use it helpfully in your training, which is why it's helpful often to have someone to guide you through that who
I do feel it would be beneficial in things, because I've worked at some gyms where we've had, like in the spin rooms, where we've had the monitors on the bike that have told you what your RPM is or your cadence and then your power output. And I think it's a good way to, particularly in a class like sprint where you're wanting people to go heavy with their load and a slow pace, but there's still people that you can tell don't have enough load on or are going too quick. Like if you had that, you could be able to say, hey, look down. Ideally, you want your cadence around this, or your power output should at least be this, to give people a better understanding of like, oh, this is how it should feel right now. But again, like you said, that just comes down to, you'd then have to be explaining what all those things mean to people and how to use that to get more out of your workout, but also not getting focused on that and also just still enjoying your workout for what it is and not getting like, oh shit, my wattage is only this much, I need to be pushing harder. So yeah, it's that fine balance, I guess, of using it to get more out of your workout but not getting too focused on it.
Yeah. I mean, the applications for everyday people of some of the exercise science tools that are quite technical, they probably don't hold that much utility in everyday training. It's really sort of like if you're wanting to track your progress over time towards a specific fitness goal, those things come in useful. If you want to be training for something in particular, those things definitely come in useful.
Yeah, that's true, because everyday people they love that shit.
Yeah, they do.
They absolutely love that shit. They prop that shit, you know? And after what you just said, there's not much utility in it unless you have something extremely specific.
Not extremely specific, but like different goals that you have, you can definitely use them to supplement measuring how you're progressing towards certain goals. But it has to be, you have to be pretty aware of those things and how,
I think people will just get it so they can screenshot what their heart rate is.
Yeah.
Send it off, which is fine. Yeah. But
that's what I just think is, what is your metric of a successful workout? Because when I see that, people be like, epic workout because they burnt 500 calories and their heart rate got to 190.
Yeah. And you're like,
I'm like,
whoa.
So if it didn't get to 190 and if you only burnt 400 calories, would it not have been a good workout? And would you not have shared that? Like,
yeah, totally.
Because that's the thing. To me, I just, well, again, it depends on what someone's goals is, but like, my goal or reason to go train and go to the gym is to feel good. So it's like, regardless of whether I burn 200 calories or 1,000 calories, I just would want to be feeling good afterwards. So I guess, depending on what people's metric of measuring a successful workout or a good workout. But yeah, I think people get hung up on numbers when probably don't need to get hung up on numbers.
Yeah, I was actually thinking a little bit about why it can be quite difficult. And with trackers and all this information that we get around, basically like when we work out from our smartwatches or whatever, like why it is that people feel very empowered and sort of overconfident in their abilities to like interpret that data and use it to inform their training in a way. And I think it's kind of that beginner's bubble idea, you know, where you're kind of unconsciously incompetent in some part of something. You have some knowledge, but that knowledge kind of propels you into an overconfidence in your ability to engage with it and use it. And what's missing from that is sort of the feedback being like, wait, no, what you chose to use that to inform the behavior or the outcome you use that metric to inform is probably erroneous, or it's a misinterpretation. So like the max heart rate thing, continuing to use max heart rate as a metric of how well you worked out and whether or not you worked out hard enough will cause you to get overtrained, most likely. if that's what you're going to gun for every single workout. But because people do have access to that information and as a sort of basic idea of how it could be used, but not the full picture.
Yeah.
I think, you sort of see some misattributions of like, or misuse of those tools.
Yeah.
When they could offer a lot more.
Yeah.
In certain situations.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just can picture science one day progressing to the point that people have their own like VO2 max testing kits and they rock up to the gym with a and they're sort of like, need all my stats because I've got to do a sprint class. Okay.
What are you going to do with it afterwards?
How's that going to
Sometimes I see people training with the mask. The way that you just said that, and I was like, fuck, that's right. I've always wondered that. You know, when you see people training with the mask, does that work? What does that do? So it's cutting off oxygen, right?
Well, yeah, it's like an altitude training tool, right? So it sort of simulates what it's like to be training up in the mountains where the oxygen level is slightly lower, and that can help endurance athletes in particular because
But again, for everyday people, probably don't need to be wearing a mask.
You're probably all right.
Oh, good, bro.
Yeah.
I see you on the treadmill, bro. Yeah. Take it off.
Have you guys done any work with like high performance sports? Oh, really?
I haven't myself. We at the lab at Auckland University, we sort of AUT do a lot more of that work because they're sort of more proximal to high performance sport NZ. So no, most of my work is just with your healthy active populations. Yeah, yeah. They also do some work down there with clinical populations as well, because they have a clinical exercise physiology laboratory and like program there. But
yeah, one of my mates is working there, and just she's told me about their gym, how they, in order for their athletes to prepare for if they need to go overseas or wherever, like they can adjust the temperature of the gym so it's like super hot or super cold depending on what they need to get ready for, and just all their facilities, what they've got, it sounds like incredible.
Yeah,
they've got to make sure that their athletes can be 110% prepared for whatever they need to be.
Yeah, but for your everyday
people, no.
Yeah.
So what do you say, the people that you've normally done research on is just healthy, normal, active people?
Yeah.
So what is that like, train an hour a day?
Well, for the studies that we run, the fatiguing paradigm that we kind of run, because people have to be able to get through 3 hours of exercise on a, like, continuous exercise on a bike,
kind of fit.
I got last 3 hours, god damn. I'm 45 minutes. 3 hours. Shit, so I need maybe, two shots of caffeine there.
Yeah,
so kind of elite.
that sounds elite, you know.
So, 3 hours. Yeah, sort of recreationally trained, I think.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, okay. Is the term.
Yeah, I don't even know if I would fall into that category. I'd be an outlier. I'd be in the exclusion criteria.
I mean, there have been participants that you're really you're really coaxing on to get through. It's like, please don't drop out, because then I have to find another person and
wow.
And just get through it.
Yeah. Well, if you ever want to do short burst studies, we'll be there. But
your 5 minute bursts. I'm good for like 30, 45.
I could do 45 to an hour, but no, you can't, not much more.
You can't.
I only did an hour this morning.
This isn't the high lying club. It's the high frequency. <Yeah. system. laughs> So we love to leave our listeners with practical tips. Our listeners probably just work out maybe 45 minutes to an hour a day. What would your practical advice be to help them, you know, better their lifestyles?
When it comes to your own training, have a healthy skepticism of supplements and really try to evaluate as best as you can what it's claiming and how true to those claims it can actually be, given the evidence there for it, and go to a number of different sources for that evidence. Don't just go, you know, a Google search is good, but
read multiple things, not just the first one.
Yeah, and if you can access some scientific studies, then that can be really helpful
get
as well.
Get on PubMed.
Get on PubMed, or ask someone who knows how to look at that literature and can give you some type of read on that. And then also with tracking tools and or like physiological monitoring tools, I think asking what you're using it for and how is that adding to your training, is it, and sort of framing it in the context of what your goals actually are. I mean, if it's not taking anything away from you and you just like to track them, then that's all good. But when it gets to the point when it's kind of you're using it to really, you're using that tool to direct your training approach, then it's a good time to probably question, what am I using it for? How could I engage? What's the best way to engage with this? Do I understand the limitations of this tool? And given those limitations, how is it best to interpret what I'm seeing and use that to direct my behavior? And that's such a personal thing. I know it's kind of vague, but it'll change depending on what someone's goals are. And then I guess sort of at that awareness of what you probably don't know when it comes to some of these things, it's not that that's not a bad thing. It's just that in some cases, the things that we don't know can make us vulnerable to kind of like using something for a really long time when it's not actually that beneficial for us. And so being able to look for guidance in the right places on those things, I think can be really helpful. Yeah.
Awesome. Right? Take and that. Do you even need people to as experiments?
Yeah, we do actually.
Okay, awesome. Plug it. Plug it.
I mean, well, right now the both of the my graduate students are actually doing really well with their recruitment, so they don't. But my sister's partner, Andreas, he needs well-trained cyclists, and he's interested in doing some work around carbohydrate restriction. So he'll get you to work out pretty hard and either deplete you of carbohydrate or give you some.
Give me all the carbs. I'll be in that group.
So, yeah, if anyone's a good cyclist or quite well trained and happy to...
He's all right on a stationary bike.
Is that yeah, no, yeah. No, happy to do some hard exercise a couple of times for around 2 to 3 hours, then yeah, give me a buzz.
Awesome. Where can people find you to hit you up?
Just go, well, you can find me on ResearchGate actually, if you want to look at any of my research. Charlie JW Connell will be the name to look for, and then on Instagram, so Charlie JW Connell as well.
Awesome. Yeah. Thanks so much, Char, for sharing your knowledge and expertise on this.
That's all right.
I learned so much. My brain is loaded. Yeah. Awesome. Thank you.
That's okay. That's a vibe. She wanna vibe. That's a vibe.